lunch today. Very tasty, thank you. My name is Ben. I'm a volunteer at the James A. Garfield National Historic Site. And I'll introduce our keynote speaker here in just a moment. I'll tell you a quick biography of Dan Vermilya. Dan is a native of Kirtland, so welcome to Dan. Civil War historian, is currently a National Park Service park ranger at Gettysburg National Military Park. Prior to that, seasonal park ranger with Antietam, and also a volunteer back here at James A. Garfield National Historic Site. Dan earned his BA in History and Politics from Hillsdale College, and then went on and completed a Master's of History from John Carroll University. Dan, in addition to authoring James A. Garfield and the Civil War, Dan has also authored Battle of Kennesaw Mountain. It is my privilege to go ahead and introduce today's keynote speaker, Daniel J. Vermilya.
Appreciate it. All right, well, good afternoon, everyone. How are we all doing?
Good,
all right. I like to ask how people are doing up front, and if I get a real tepid response, that kind of tells me I need to bring people awake, so I'm glad we're doing well today. Well, I want to thank everybody for having me here, Andy and Todd and everybody for putting such a great event on here. It's a real privilege to be here with everybody. It's great to be back home in Ohio. Of course, I pick, you know, November and the winter months to come back to Ohio when normally people are fleeing this state this time of year, so I have my timing down right there. Well, today's topic, of course, is Garfield in Washington. Just this week, my book on Garfield and the Civil War just came out, published by the History Press. In it, I take a look at Garfield's Civil War career, which really was a opening for him in a lot of different ways. When we think of Garfield in Washington, oftentimes it's scenes like this that come to mind. Him being inaugurated as president, the whole, born in a log cabin, impoverished youth, canal worker, all the way to the highest office in the land. It's, of course, the most important title he held in his life. Of course, we also think of scenes like this, his tragic death and assassination. And I've heard it said many times here today that it's unfortunate that Garfield's name is most associated with tragedy. He's a tragic figure in a lot of ways. He's a young man, a lot of promise still when he's gunned down just a few months into his presidency. But it's important to note that actually the first time Garfield arrived in Washington was in much different circumstances. When he arrived in Washington, he was not wearing the title of congressman. He was not wearing the title of president. He was a brigadier general in the United States Army. He was wearing this uniform instead with a star on his shoulder. By September of 1862, when James Garfield arrived in Washington, he had already established himself as a successful Civil War general. So today I'd like to take a look at what Garfield did in Washington during the Civil War from September of 1862 all the way until the end of the war. I know other talks today have focused on other parts of Garfield's time in Washington, but I wanted to take a look at this part of his life, this time he spent in Washington. And I wanted to briefly recap what leads him up to this point. I'm not sure if everybody's really familiar with Garfield's Civil War career and his Civil War story. So I wanted to take a moment just up front in our program today to just briefly recap how he gets to Washington in September of 1862. By 1861, when the Civil War begins, when these states across the country are breaking apart, beginning to wage a war with itself, James Garfield is an Ohio state senator, and he arrives there just as this grand state house is being completed. Garfield is going to be a quickly rising figure. He's actually about my age when he's in the state senate, so he's a very accomplished man at a very young age. And he and Jacob Cox, who we're going to hear about this afternoon from Gene Schmiel, he and Jacob Cox formed a very strong friendship. He was outspoken on a lot of different matters. Garfield gave a speech in July of 1860 in Ravenna where he said that the Union was as likely to split apart as were the waters of the Mississippi River. So initially, he doesn't really think that the nation's going to come to war. But of course, in April of 1861, that's exactly what happens. April 12th, shots are fired on Fort Sumter in Charleston Harbor. The day that Fort Sumter falls to Confederate forces, Garfield is offering his services to Governor William Dennison to serve in the Ohio Volunteers that will be raised. And he is writing a letter on the day that Fort Sumter falls saying he would rather lose 1 million men in battle than see the nation be torn apart. No one else, virtually no one else is saying that at that point in the war, that this would become such a bloody conflict. Ultimately, there were over 1.5 million casualties, killed, wounded, and missing during the course of the Civil War. Garfield's estimate, while it seemed extremely high in April of 1861, was actually low. He's also saying that this war is going to be fatal to slavery. Virtually no one else is saying that at that point in time. Garfield waited a few months. He was trying to get an appointment, trying to get a commission. His first role was as raising the 42nd Ohio Infantry. He became the commander for this regiment of soldiers. He led the 42nd Ohio and several other regiments of Union soldiers in a brigade, the 18th Brigade of the Army of the Ohio, in what was known as the Big Sandy Valley Campaign. Normally when I talk about Garfield during the war, this is the point where I ask, how many of you have heard of the Big Sandy Valley Campaign before? Now, this is kind of an outlier group because a lot of folks here know a lot about Garfield, but normally I get one or two hands at most. And I'm doing this at places like Gettysburg and Antietam, where you'd think, gosh, well, these people must know everything there is to know about the Civil War. But the Big Sandy Valley Campaign, it's really a unknown part of the war. It's in the far eastern reaches of Kentucky. There's difficult weather. Garfield is inexperienced troops. He's going up against a much more experienced officer for the Confederates in Humphrey Marshall, and he defeats him at the Battle of Middle Creek, January 10th of 1862. This is what gives Garfield praise from state legislatures in Ohio and Kentucky, and this is what ultimately leads him to be promoted to the rank of Brigadier General. Being promoted to Brigadier General means that Garfield has a new command. He's commanding another brigade in the Army of the Ohio. He arrives late in the day on the second day of the Battle of Shiloh, not in time to take part in combat, but in time to ride across the battlefield and see thousands and thousands of dead soldiers, to see a sight the likes of which no one in American history had ever seen before. There were more battle casualties at Shiloh than there were American military deaths in the Revolutionary War, the War of 1812, and the War with Mexico combined. And Garfield is seeing this aftermath as a brigadier general in April of 1862. That summer, Garfield became very depressed. He said that it was like a moment of Valley Forge for himself and for the nation. He actually used that term. It was a moment darker in time than Washington's winter at Valley Forge. He became very ill that summer. His experiences on the battlefield made him very radical regarding the institution of slavery, wanting to see the federal government take more and more aggressive action against it. By August of 1862, he was actually sent home on sick leave. A board of doctors and surgeons in Columbus said that he needed to take at least a month off from his duties in the Army. He had become jaundiced. He had lost over 40 pounds. He was very, very ill. So he spends August 1862 at home with his wife Lucretia, who we have pictured here. And that is when he is nominated to run for Congress. August of 1862 gives Garfield some time at home to recharge so that when he's ready to rejoin the war in September of 1862, he can approach it with the energy necessary. Now, by September of 1862, again, Garfield has seen combat in eastern Kentucky. He has experienced a very low point during that summer. And overall, the Union war effort in September of 1862 is not going very well. Garfield wrote in a letter to his close friend Burke Aaron Hinsdale on September 12th of 1862, saying, "The war is now strangely mixed. The days are sufficiently dark. We can never hope for peace till we crush up or disperse their heavy armies," of course referring to the Confederacy, "and remove the active cause of the sectional feud. It may be a philosophical question whether 11,000 of people can be subdued, for we no longer need disguise the fact that this is the thing to be done before there can be union and peace." Garfield also expressed worry that Jefferson Davis would declare emancipation before President Lincoln could. This was September 12th of 1862. Within a few days, Garfield traveled to Washington. That was his introduction to the city. Of course, the United States Capitol still being finished at that time, much as the country itself was still being finished at that time, going through the fiery trial of the American Civil War. But he arrives on September 19th of 1862, and the date is very important because he's arriving in the midst of one of the most important months in American history. 2 days before September 19th was the bloodiest day in the history of the United States, before, ever since. Battle of Antietam in Western Maryland. I used to work at Antietam Battlefield. Over 23,000 casualties there in 12 hours. Garfield's arriving in the capital 2 days after that. The Battle of Antietam resulted in a Union victory. It's a matter of a lot of debate today whether it's a stalemate or Union victory. Myself and a lot of others call it a Union victory because the Confederate army that had come north into Maryland, a border state still in the Union, was repulsed there because of heavy losses. Robert E. Lee was forced to retreat out of Maryland. Abraham Lincoln had been waiting for a victory such as this just a few days after the battle. Abraham Lincoln issues his Emancipation Proclamation. Now remember, on the 12th of September, Garfield's saying, well, we need to strike at the Confederacy. I'm really worried that Jefferson Davis is going to declare emancipation before we do. 10 days later, Lincoln issues his preliminary Emancipation Proclamation. And this is something that Garfield had thought of for quite some time. Back in February of 1862, in fact, he wrote in a letter that this was something that needed to be done, saying that this war will result fatally to slavery, I have no doubt. But he thought that the timing then in February of 62 was not quite right. But once Lincoln issues this proclamation, Garfield was overjoyed. He wrote just a few days later on September 25th, I am rejoiced at the president's proclamation. It gives us light in the midst of darkness and shows us the beginning of the end. Now, of course, the proclamation took its final effect on January 1st of 1863, and the following day, Garfield wrote one of my favorite quotes from his wartime writings. He said, strange that a second-rate Illinois lawyer should be the instrument through whom one of the sublimest works of any age is accomplished. How many of you today would describe Abraham Lincoln as a second-rate Illinois lawyer? Okay, let the record reflect, no hands went up. Well, Garfield himself, he's like, all right, this is good. I didn't think Lincoln was going to do it, but this is good. So he's arriving in Washington just days before Lincoln issues the preliminary Emancipation Proclamation. What a grand time to be in the nation's capital. Now, when Garfield first arrives in the city, he is staying at the famed Willard Hotel. This is one of the most historic spots in our nation's capital. Pretty much everybody in the who's who's list of American history has stayed there at one point or another. Every president since Franklin Pierce has either slept there or attended an event there. This is where Lincoln stayed before his inauguration. This is where Grant stayed when he came to Washington in March of 64 to receive his appointment as Lieutenant General. The list of writers, literary figures, Mark Twain, Walt Whitman, Charles Dickens, they all stayed there. This is where Garfield stays when he first arrives in Washington in September of 1862. But soon he would find a new place to rest his head while he was in the nation's capital. He had essentially come to Washington because he was done with his sick leave. He came back to this city, or he came to this city, because he needed a new assignment in the Union Army. He's looking for a new role to play. After staying at the Willard for about a week, he actually is taken in by Salmon Chase, one of the famed team of rivals that Doris Kearns Goodwin wrote of in her famed book. He's the Secretary of the Treasury in the Lincoln administration. He's from Ohio. He's a prominent Republican. I know Andy was talking about him earlier on in one of the sessions. This is a really powerful guy, and he takes Garfield into his home. And this is starting a political friendship between the two, almost a mentorship during the Civil War years. Through Salmon Chase, Garfield becomes very well connected in the Capitol. And Garfield really liked Salmon Chase. He said, Mr. Chase seems to be the only member of the cabinet who stands up firmly with Stanton, referring to Edwin Stanton, the Secretary of War, for the vigorous prosecution of the war, for freedom's and the Union's sake. Now, those are the words that I had on the opening slide as the title of my talk today, for freedom's and the Union's sake. Garfield is a very passionate individual during the American Civil War. He believes very strongly in waging this war with a vengeance, with both fists, not having one arm tied behind the Union's back. And he believes this for the sake of freedom, in terms of abolishing slavery in the United States, and keeping this country together and the promise of freedom together. Garfield sees in Chase someone who is an advocate for freedom in the Union within the Lincoln administration, someone who is an advocate for waging the war with the aggressiveness that it needs. Now, Garfield, when he was staying with Chase, he hoped for other posts in the Army, but in fact, his next fight was going to be political. Washington, D.C., of course, today is a very divisive place, right? We hear it all the time about the partisan bickering. Well, guess what? It's always been that way. Especially during the Civil War, right? This is literally the time that half the country was fighting a war against the other half because they didn't like each other. Okay? Now, in Washington, D.C., within the Union Army, you have a lot of tensions, especially between these two guys here. The fancy-looking general there, that's, of course, George Brinton McClellan. And the other man is Edwin Stanton, the Secretary of War. The Lincoln administration did not like George McClellan. He is a conservative figure in the Army. He wants this war to end with as little radical political change to this country as possible. The Lincoln administration, of course, just issued the Emancipation Proclamation. McClellan doesn't really agree with the direction the war is going. These tensions overflow to two generals in the field. Fitzjohn Porter, commander of the Union 5th Corps in the summer of 1862, and John Pope, who was the commander of the Union Army of Virginia and was in favor of waging this war against the Confederacy with an iron fist. Well, Porter and Pope didn't really like each other a whole lot. Porter wrote some very unflattering letters about Pope. They were handed off, and eventually found their ways into the hands of the Lincoln administration and John Pope himself. So these two guys don't really get along. Well, this boils over at the Battle of Second Bull Run, Second Manassas, in late August of 1862. At Second Manassas, John Pope is in command of the Union Army there. He issues some orders to Fitzjohn Porter to launch an attack on the second day of the battle, on August 29th. Porter doesn't launch the attack. Pope is furious with him. Turns out, later on, that Porter actually had good reason not to launch the attack because the orders are conflicted, and there's a large Confederate force on his flank. If he moves forward, these guys are going to get slaughtered. Ultimately, the Union Army loses the battle dramatically. It's one of the biggest victories for the Confederates in the entire Civil War. And afterwards, Pope is looking to blame somebody. He's going to bring Fitzjohn Porter up on charges of insubordination for his conduct at Second Manassas. Now, how does all of this relate to James Garfield? Well, there has to be a court-martial hearing for Fitzjohn Porter. And James Garfield is going to be one of those named to be on this court-martial. Remember, he's in Washington thinking that he's going to be sent to the Cumberland Gap, or he's going to be sent to Florida. He's going to get another post in the field. He wants battle. He wants glory. But instead, he's got to sit on this political court-martial. And remember, he's staying in the home of one of Lincoln's secretaries, one of the Secretary of the Treasury. So he's very well connected. Now, Garfield's position in this matter, he's going to come into the Fitzjohn Porter trial with an already developed opinion. He'd already sat down and talked with the man pictured here, Irvin McDowell, one of those whose conduct at Second Manassas came into question after the battle. And McDowell gave his version of events to Garfield, and Garfield bought into McDowell's version, and this is all before Garfield sits on this court. So it would essentially be as if you are the plaintiff or defendant in a trial, and before the trial even meets, your judge or one of the jury members has met with the other side. The other side has told him their entire version of events. So by the time you go to sit in that jury box, you already have your own idea on how this war is being fought on the matter. So that's going to be the case with Garfield. Garfield had a very strong frustration with West Point officers during the Civil War. He has a frustration with these professional military officers because he believes they're not waging the war properly. They're not waging the war with enough aggression. And Fitzjohn Porter is a close friend of George McClellan, and he is enemy number one of the administration at this point. Garfield actually wrote this in October of 1862. If the Republic goes down in blood and ruin, let its obituary be written thus, died of West Point. So this is a guy with some pretty strong opinions coming into this court-martial. The court-martial itself meets in December of 1862. Garfield, you can see him right there. In the middle of all of this, there's a lot of other prominent Union officers. Pretty much every Union officer who is sitting on this court-martial has some connection to the administration. One journalist said that the court was organized by Secretary Stanton. Here we go. The court was chosen by Secretary Stanton and was organized to convict. So we might properly describe this as a hanging jury. It's not one of the more flattering parts of Garfield's Civil War career that he is sitting on this court-martial. But it's part of his career nonetheless. And it shows that already in 1862, before he was even elected to Congress, Garfield is already becoming involved in the politics of Washington. Ultimately, Fitzjohn Porter pictured here again, is convicted on these charges, cashiered from the army. The verdict would be overturned years later in the late 1870s. But Garfield went to his grave believing in Porter's guilt, even though today many historians believe that Porter was innocent of the charges. Garfield later wrote to John Pope, "No public act with which I have been connected was ever more clear to me than the righteousness of the finding of that court." Well, no sooner has the Porter trial wrapped up than Garfield goes back into the field. He is now going to be the chief of staff for the Army of the Cumberland, serving under William Stark Rosecrans. Rosecrans is fresh off his victory at Stones River. Not Chickamauga yet, a little ahead of myself. Off his victory at Stones River. And Garfield is coming in January of 1863 at a time that Rosecrans is trying to rebuild this army. Now, a lot of times, a chief of staff has some sort of West Point education, a military background, years of service in the regular army. You don't typically have a chief of staff who has no professional military training, who's a volunteer guy like Garfield. But think about this. He's this incredibly bright guy. In his late 20s, he's the head of a college. So if there's ever a guy who can learn how to do this job, it's going to be James Garfield. Garfield plays a big role in the success of the Tullahoma campaign that summer. There's dissatisfaction growing between Rosecrans and Washington, D.C. over the way the war is being waged. Garfield's going to vent a lot of his frustrations in letters to Washington, especially to this guy, Salmon Chase. Some of these letters are later on going to be used to say that Garfield is trying to stab Rosecrans in the back. I think what it is Garfield's so frustrated with the war is going, with the way the war is going, he's venting in letters. And he's venting in them to the same man who took him in September of 1862, his political mentor in the Capitol. Of course, Garfield is at the bloody Battle of Chickamauga in September of 1863. On the final day of Chickamauga, September 20th, with the Union Army dissolving in the midst of a major Confederate onslaught, Garfield will bravely and heroically ride through the debris of battle, through the debris of a defeated and retreating army to link up with George Thomas, making the final stand for the Union Army of the Cumberland on a place known as Horseshoe Ridge and Snodgrass Hill. Of course, this is a painting for the James A. Garfield National Historic Site depicting that great ride that Garfield made, his famous ride to glory. After Chickamauga, with the defeat of the Union Army, Garfield would leave the army once and for all. While he was in Washington in the fall of 1862, Garfield had indeed been elected to Congress, representing his home district in the state of Ohio. But at that time, Congress was not meeting quite as much as they are meeting today. Congress was not going to meet until December of 1863. So Garfield did not have to leave the army right away, which is how he was allowed to stay in the army, even as a congressman-elect. He, in fact, even wrote Attorney General Edward Bates asking him if he had to leave the army just yet. And Bates said, no, you can resign when your term begins. So Garfield will resign from Congress in December of 1863, just days after his first daughter died of illness. And now we have Congressman James Garfield. Now, Garfield's military career is the focus of the book that I've just written. But I also wanted to say a little bit in the last chapter of the book on his time in Congress during the war. Because Garfield is bringing his perspective to the halls of Congress, the perspective of a combat veteran. This is a guy who has seen the aftermath of Shiloh, who saw the Battle of Chickamauga, which, with over 34,000 casualties, was the second bloodiest battle of the war, second only to Gettysburg. This is a guy who knows what this war is like. So as a congressman, he's arriving in Washington having military experience. He was somewhat conflicted about leaving the army for Congress. He spoke with President Lincoln, who told him that he needed a congressman who knew the wants of the armies from practical knowledge. So Lincoln's going to nudge Garfield towards Congress rather than staying in the army. But certainly, it is still an unfinished war when Garfield arrives in Congress in late 1863. Garfield is a member of the 38th Congress with many distinguished individuals in it. Among these individuals, some famous names such as Thaddeus Stevens. Garfield, of course, right here in this image from the Library of Congress. A Portage County newspaper described him as a young congressman, saying that Garfield's voice is heard. Every ear attends. His eloquent words move the heart, convince the reason, and tell the weak and wavering which way to go. He's a guy with great rhetorical abilities, a lot of passion, and he's going to bring that passion and that experience to bear in his time in the U.S. Congress. One of his first major speeches was in January of 1864, and he was speaking on the confiscation of Confederate property. And he really brought the fire and brimstone for this speech. He said, "I tell you, gentlemen, the heart of this great rebellion cannot be softened by smiles. You cannot send commissioners to Richmond to smile away the horrible facts of this war. Not by smiles, but by thundering volleys must this rebellion be met, and by such means alone. Mr. Speaker, if we want a peace that is not a hollow peace, we must follow that example and make thorough work of this war. We must establish freedom in the midst of servitude and the authority of law in the midst of rebellion." Garfield said that this was an abolition war. Now, Garfield was finding his place in Congress at this time. His long 17-year congressional career began in the final year of the Civil War, when the Congress is trying to figure out exactly how this is all going to be wrapped up and what kind of country is going to be left in the aftermath of combat. Garfield is a radical, but he's not necessarily following the party line on everything. He has disagreements with Thaddeus Stevens, the firebrand abolitionist from Pennsylvania. Garfield is going to stay with Robert Schenck, pictured here as well, himself a congressman from Ohio and a former general. And Garfield is going to be on the Military Affairs Committee. Schenck was a widower, so he and Garfield got along well. They had a lot of time together to talk about matters of the war and politics. Their home together in Washington kind of became an unofficial army meeting place where a lot of military officers came to talk with them about the way the war was continuing. And Garfield did develop as a strong nationalist during this time, wanting to see the federal government do everything within its power to bring this war, to bring this rebellion to a successful conclusion. One of Garfield's first major efforts in Congress was in defending the draft. Now, the draft is something that the Union desperately needed in 1864. Garfield knew this because he had seen what happens to these armies when they're chewed up and torn apart on the battlefield. There needs to be a constant influx of new soldiers. Generals in the field knew this. Garfield knew this as well. Lincoln himself knew the draft needed to be reauthorized. He supposedly told this committee, of which Garfield was a part, "It is not necessary for me to be reelected, but it is necessary for me to put down this rebellion. And you give me that law, and I will put it down before my successor takes his seat." Of course, 1864, an election year, Lincoln, uncertain of his reelection, wants to make sure this war is won one way or another. In June of 1864, Garfield gave a passionate speech, pleading with his fellow congressmen to fill the nation's armies. He hearkened back to European history of citizens fighting for their country. He said of the volunteer soldiers in the field, "They are proud of their voluntary service. And if there be one wish of the army paramount to all others, one message more earnest than any other, which they send back to you, is that you will aid in filling their battle-thin ranks by a draft that will compel lukewarm citizens who prayed against the war to go into the field." He spoke of those who had not yet served as those with lukewarm citizenship. Of course, we can only imagine that Garfield's citizenship and fervor was at a boil now for several years running at this point. The draft was reauthorized and Garfield was successful. But as I noted, it is 1864 and the president is up for reelection, Garfield as well. Now, although Garfield had met Lincoln several times, by 1864, he was not wildly enthusiastic about the president and his reelection. It seems almost a foregone conclusion for us today that Abraham Lincoln was going to be reelected in 1864. That was far from the case that year. It wasn't even a certainty that he was going to be renominated. Some wanted Salmon Chase to be the nominee of the Republicans for president at this time. Garfield ultimately realized that Lincoln needed to be the nominee. Many people in his home district still supported the president, but he did say privately, "The administration is not all I could wish." "It seems clear to me that the people desire the reelection of Mr. Lincoln. I believe any movement in any other direction will not only be a failure, but will tend to disturb and embarrass the unity of the friends of the Union." So despite his lukewarm feelings towards the president, we might say, similar to that lukewarm citizenship he spoke of in regards to the draft, Garfield is going to say he will support the president if need be. Of course, Abraham Lincoln is reelected in 1864 with Andrew Johnson as his running mate, and James Garfield is reelected in 1864 as well. On the campaign trail that year, though, Garfield didn't speak often of Lincoln. He spoke most often of the Democrats and their ideas on the war, claiming that they were not fully supporting the Union cause. He said, "Why is the war a failure to them? It is only a failure because if it succeeds, they fail. What do you say to a party whose success depends upon the destruction of their country?" So he is a passionate spokesman on the trail. In January of 1865, Garfield is going to play a role in the passage of the 13th Amendment. And this is really a pretty awesome moment in his life story. Garfield is born in 1831, around the same time as the Nat Turner slave rebellion in Virginia. He's born into a log cabin in Ohio at a time when slavery is tearing apart this nation. Of course, it would be years before the war. And now, as a young congressman in January of 1865, Garfield is giving a passionate speech in favor of the 13th Amendment. Unfortunately, Steven Spielberg did not include this moment in the movie Lincoln. But Garfield said at the start of the speech, "We shall never know why slavery dies so hard in this republic and in this hall till we know why sin has such longevity and Satan is immortal. With marvelous tenacity of existence, it has outlived the expectations of its friends and the hopes of its enemies. It has been declared here and elsewhere to be in all the several stages of mortality, wounded, dying, and dead." He said, "So, sir, this body of slavery lies before us among the dead enemies of the republic, mortally wounded." He said the slavery was lying mortally wounded. It was up to Congress to finish it off, which it ultimately did by passing the 13th Amendment. Within a few months of this, in April of 1865, the war is coming to a close, Robert E. Lee surrendering at Appomattox on April 9th. Within the coming weeks, other Confederate armies would surrender as well. And by April of 1865, James Garfield had come to appreciate Lincoln in his own right. Of course, the similarities between these two men, these two political figures, is incredible, or are incredible, I should say. Garfield first met Lincoln when the president-elect at that time was coming through Ohio on his way towards Washington in February of 1861. And he met with him several other times during his Civil War career. On April 14th of 1865 and April 15th, Garfield was in New York. Of course, that was when President Lincoln was assassinated. On April 15th of 1866, April 14th of 1866, Garfield gave a eulogy for the president on his one-year anniversary of his death on the House floor. And the similarities between him describing Lincoln's assassination and the fate which would soon approach for Garfield are incredible. He said, "The last 5 years have been marked by wonderful developments of individual character. Thousands of our people, before unknown to fame, have taken their places in history, crowned with immortal honors. In thousands of humble homes are dwelling heroes and patriots whose names shall never die. But greatest among these developments were the character and fame of Abraham Lincoln, whose loss the nation still deplores." Well, little did Garfield know that while describing the death of Abraham Lincoln and how he had risen to become a hero during the Civil War, Garfield himself was among those unknown heroes who rose to fame and prominence during that war. And of course, in remembering the assassination of one president, Garfield himself would become the victim of an assassin less than 20 years later. Many different parallels exist between those events. Perhaps the capstone event, the final event for the war in Washington, was the Grand Review in May of 1865. For 2 days, thousands of Union soldiers filled the streets of the Capitol parading through the city. It was a grand moment. Of the five Union veterans who would eventually go on to be president, four of them were present for this. The only one not was William McKinley, who was still in Virginia. Ulysses S. Grant was there. He was with President Johnston on the viewing stand. Harrison was there. He was marching with his men from Indiana. And Rutherford Hayes and James Garfield were watching from the congressional viewing stand. And with thousands of soldiers strolling through the streets, it was signaling a moment of victory for the Union. A victory which delivered new opportunities for the nation, new opportunities which James Garfield himself would fight for during his post-war political career, opportunities which he had done his part trying to secure during his time in the Army and his time in Washington. While he had many different posts during the Civil War, his time in Washington was his real introduction to national politics. His time in Washington allowed him to cross paths with so many other leaders. Salmon Chase, Edwin Stanton, Thaddeus Stevens, and President Lincoln himself. Because of these interactions, Garfield became a strong politician in the post-war years of Reconstruction. So much so that 16 years later, Garfield was watching another parade in Washington. This one, his inaugural parade. As president, he didn't have a whole lot of time, of course, to live up to the promise of his election. The tragedy of his death, as I noted at the outset, really overshadows a lot of the rest of Garfield's life. But one area of heroism in his life that is often lost in this is his Civil War service, part of which did occur in Washington, D.C. during the war. James Garfield was a man of many different titles during his life. He was a student, a teacher, a preacher, a college president, a state senator, a recruiter for the Army, a colonel, a brigadier general, a major general by the time he left the Army, a congressman, a presidential candidate, and the president of the United States. But perhaps personally, in many of his speeches, it was another title that meant the most to him. He was also a veteran. A veteran of combat, oftentimes that is the salient part of someone's experience. For many Civil War veterans, no matter what they did for the rest of their lives, their Civil War experience lingered with them for years. While Garfield spent the next 17 years as a congressman in Washington, ultimately becoming president, effectively spending the rest of his professional life in Washington after the war, it was his time during the war which had a strong, profound, and lingering effect through all those years. He gave many speeches to veterans groups. He spoke frequently of the war and its meaning and its legacy. And one of those actually was given not technically in Washington, but just across the river from it. I've included the text of this speech in my book on Garfield during the war. In 1868, for the first time, there was an official dedication day. Excuse me, not dedication. I'm thinking too much of Gettysburg on November 19th. It was Decoration Day, where the graves of those who gave their lives that the nation might live were adorned with flowers, and individuals came forward to give thanks. It, of course, is the origins of Memorial Day. And on May 30th of 1868, Congressman Garfield gave a speech at the cemetery at Arlington. His speech is incredible. It has the flowery language you would expect from Garfield, the high rhetoric you would expect from Garfield. He said in part, "For the noblest man that still lives, there remains a conflict. He must withstand the assaults of time and fortune, must still be assailed with temptations before which lofty natures have fallen. But with these," referring to those dead, those who had been buried, giving their lives during the war, "with these, the conflict ended. The victory was won, when death stamped on them the great seal of heroic character and closed a record which years can never blot." Garfield said of the war, and the nation was summoned to arms by every high motive which can inspire men. 2 centuries of freedom had made its people unfit for despotism. They must save their government, or miserably perish. And he said of those who took part in the war, himself included, "With such inspirations," referring to the ideals of freedom in the Union, for freedom's in the Union's sake, "with such inspirations, failure was impossible. The struggle consecrated, in some degree, every man who bore a worthy part." Garfield as a congressman, Garfield as a president, was consecrated by his time in the Army during the Civil War. Thanks so much for taking part in this great event today. Not sure if we wanted to have any questions. I do have copies of my new book on James Garfield and the War available, as well as some copies of my first book on the Battle of Kennesaw Mountain, if anyone is interested. So, thank you very much.